Hello, this is a revision podcast for Edexcel IGCSE, and this is on topic 3, waves. There are two kinds of waves, transverse and longitudinal waves. Longitudinal waves vibrate back and forth in the direction in which the wave travels. This could be a slinky spring. Here are areas where the spring has been compressed. The spring will pass on that vibration to the adjacent particle. That particle will move forwards and then move back into position. The wave moves across to the right, but the particles themselves move forwards and backwards. Areas where the waves are close together are compressions, and areas where they're spread apart are called refractions. Transverse waves vibrate up and down across the direction of travel. In this example, the wave is moving to the right, but the water, in this if it was a water wave, or the particles would move up and then back down again. The wavelength is the distance from one peak to the next, and the amplitude from the centre of a wave to the top. Both of these kinds of waves transfer energy, although neither of them transfer any matter. The time period is the time it takes to make one complete oscillation. So that will be measured in seconds, which are the standard units for time. The frequency is the number of vibrations made in a second, and that has standard units of hertz, which means the number per second. In this graph, you can see that as the time period reduces, the frequency increases. In fact, the relationship between frequency and time period is reciprocal. Frequency is 1 over the time period. You're given this equation on the Edexcel paper. Here's an example using that equation. If a jigsaw blade vibrates up and down at a frequency of 80 Hz, how long does it take to make one complete vibration? That's the time period. You'd rearrange this formula to make T the subject. That will be T equals 1 over F. Substitute the data, 80 Hz, 1 over 80, is 0.0125 seconds. That's the time period for the jigsaw blade. The wave equation relates the wave speed to the wave's frequency and its wavelength. The letter lambda is a Greek L, and that represents the wave length. As the frequency of a wave decreases, the wavelength increases. For example, if the waves at the shore of a beach arrive at a frequency of 0.4 Hz and are 8 meters apart, calculate the wave speed. So you'd use this equation in this form. Wave speed would be the frequency times by the wavelength gives 3.2 meters per second. Note that the units here are standard, so the output units are also standard units for speed, or meters per second. Any wave involving electromagnetic waves would travel at the speed of light. So if a question asked you, Radio 1 is broadcasting a radio wave at 97.9 megahertz, what would be its wavelength? You'd rearrange this equation to make lambda the subject. So if you use a triangle, cover up this term, and that leaves V divided by F. Lambda is speed over frequency, so 3 times 10 to the 8 over 97.9 times 10 to the 6, that's 97.9 million, gives 3.06 meters. When waves pass through a gap, they spread out slightly. This process is called diffraction. Diffraction is greatest when the wavelength of the wave, that's the distance from one peak to the next, is about the same size as the width of the gap. In this drawing, this shows about maximum diffraction, as the wavelength here is about the same size as the gap. When you draw these diagrams, note that the wavelength remains constant throughout. The distance here is about the same as the distance here. Diffraction happens when there's only one edge. In this case, the gap is considered very large, and so the diffraction is greatest when the wavelength is very large, i.e. a very long distance gap, so a very long wave will diffract the most. All waves diffract, including light, but we don't observe light diffracting very much because its wavelength is so small you'd need a very small gap to see its diffraction. You need to know about electromagnetic waves, which are oscillations of electric and magnetic fields. That may sound confusing, but they're part of a family of well-known waves, through from long-wave radio waves to very short-wave gamma rays. All electromagnetic waves carry energy, but only the shortest wavelength ones are ionizing. Gamma rays are very ionizing, and ultraviolet the least ionizing. All electromagnetic waves travel at the same speed, that's the speed of light. Here is a mnemonic that might help you learn the spectrum in terms of frequency. It starts with gamma rays, which are the shortest wavelength, and goes to radio waves, which are the longest wavelength. I can't claim credit for this mnemonic. It was invented by one of my students. Generally, the higher the frequency, the more dangerous the electromagnetic wave. Gamma, X-rays, and ultraviolet are all ionizing. You need to know about some uses and some dangers of electromagnetic waves. Here are some statements taken from the syllabus. Radio waves are used for broadcasting, microwaves for cooking, infrared for heating, visible light, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays all have uses. And here are some dangers. Microwaves will heat your internal body tissue. They don't ionize, though. Infrared can cause skin burns. It's also not ionizing. Ultraviolet does damage to the skin's surface cells and can cause blindness. And gamma rays can cause cancer and can mutate cells. Mirrors will reflect light according to the law of reflection. That is that the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. You measure angles to the normal line, and a normal line is drawn at 90 degrees to the surface of the mirror. You need to be able to construct a diagram to show the location of an image. So here is an object that we're looking at, and the image is formed the same distance away inside the mirror. So I've drawn on the image location equidistant and level with the object here. If an observer looks at this object, they will see the image inside the mirror. This ray diagram shows you how it forms, how the image forms here. So you start off with your ruler at the position of the image, and you draw a ray that goes to the mirror and continues to the eye. That ray would have come from the object over here, and it reflects at the mirror surface. I've repeated that process for a second ray of light, and you can see they're diverging, spreading out. If you put your pencil at the object position and join a line up with where the ray hits the mirror, you will get an accurate reflection. These rays reflect off the mirror and go to the eye. These rays aren't real. They're called virtual rays, and they should be drawn dotted. So now the diagram's complete. We have an image that's inside the mirror, the same distance away, that's laterally inverted, that is swapped left to right, and that's virtual. The image can't be formed on the screen, and these rays don't really travel. There is no light here. They're virtual rays to show where the image appears. You can see reflections at mirrored surfaces and also obviously at water's edges. Refraction is what happens when a wave changes speed. Here, waves get to a boundary and they travel slower in this medium. One side of the wave travels faster than the other side of the wave, and so it overtakes and they travel in a different direction once they go into the other medium. Note that the wavelength is also shorter in the slower medium. This happens to light when it travels into glass. The angle of incidence is greater than the angle of refraction as the light bends towards the normal. The normal line here is at 90 degrees to the surface, as it was for a mirror drawing. An analogy to explain it would be a car driving from tarmac into mud. As the car drives towards the mud, eventually one wheel gets to the mud before the other wheel. This wheel will travel slower and this wheel faster, so the car will change direction. One side will be travelling faster and it will turn. Here the car has now changed direction, and once it's entered the mud, it will continue going at a straight line. When it leaves the mud on the other side, the opposite will happen, and this wheel will get traction first and the car will move back to its original path. The mathematics of refraction are that n, the refractive index of the material, is equal to sine I over sine r. And that could be put into a triangle to help you manipulate the formula. The opposite of the sine function is sine to the minus 1. You normally press shift and then sine on your calculator. You'll need that in the examples. So imagine light enters glass at an angle of 45 degrees to the normal and refracts to an angle of 30 degrees. Calculate the refractive index. The formula here is used in this form, sine I over sine r, which comes out to be 1.41. That's the refractive index of the glass, and it doesn't have units. It's a ratio. In this example, we want to know what angle light will refract to when it enters diamond at an angle. Diamond's refractive index is 2.4. Because we want to know what angle it refracts to, we need to calculate r. Our formula rearranges to give us sine of r. Sine of r is sine I over n, which comes out to be 0.319. That isn't the angle of refraction, though. To find that, we need to use the inverse sine function. So r is the inverse sine of the answer we've just got, which gives 18.6 degrees. It's worth checking when you've got an answer that it looks sensible compared to the original angle of incidence. Let's consider what happens to light when it tries to leave glass or a more optically dense material. If it travels at a fairly shallow angle, it will refract and leave the glass. It bends away from the normal, of course. If you increase the angle of incidence at this surface, eventually the light will graze along the glass surface edge. It does that at an angle called the critical angle. So at the critical angle, light bends as far as it possibly can along the surface of the glass. Beyond the critical angle, light has got nowhere left to refract, and so it reflects inside the block. All of the light energy reflects, none comes out, and so this is called total internal reflection. The relationship between the critical angle C and the refractive index of the glass is this, sine C equals 1 over n. And you could put that into a triangle to help you manipulate it again. To calculate the critical angle for perspex, if you know its refractive index is 1.4, again, you start by calculating sine of the critical angle, which is 1 over n. With that number, we then need to use the inverse sine function again to calculate the critical angle, which comes out to be close to 45 or 46 degrees. A prism can disperse light into its constituent colours. Here, white light refracts when it enters and refracts again as it leaves the prism. But the refractive index of blue light is slightly more than the refractive index for red light, so it bends slightly more and the white light is split into its constituent colours. When light hits this prism, it arrives at this surface at the normal line, and so it doesn't refract. And it hits this surface at an angle of 45 degrees to the normal, which is above the critical angle, and so it reflects. The same process happens again here, and we've used these prisms to create a periscope. SLR cameras use prisms to reflect light, down through the lens of the camera so that you see a picture of what you're about to take. Light can be transmitted along optic fibres as a digital signal. The light flashes on and off quickly to represent a code of ones and zeros, which is a binary code. Light hits the edge at an angle greater than the critical angle between the two materials, and so always totally internally reflects. Analog signals take any shape or size, but digital signals are either on or off. When you transmit signals along in any medium, noise can distort them. Let's have a look at the distorted signals. So here's the signals with some noise added to them. You can see the analog signal has lost some of its original integrity. We could clear this up, but it would be less like the original shape. Whereas a digital signal, you can still interpret as ones and zeros. You still know if the voltage is high or low, or in this case, if the light intensity is bright or dim. So digital signals are less prone to noise by interference, and the original can be cleared up. Sound waves are longitudinal vibrations of air molecules. The air from a loudspeaker moves back and forwards and knocks into the molecules of its neighbours, creating a compression wave. Like other waves, sound can be reflected, that's an echo, it can be refracted, and it can be diffracted. You need to know an experiment to measure the speed of sound. To do so, you'd need some people a large distance away from a loud sound. You'd use a gun, you'd fire the gun, and you'd watch for the smoke. The people would start the stopwatch when they saw the smoke and stop it when they hear the bang. They'd use the equation speed equals distance over time to calculate the speed that the sound had taken to travel. There are other methods for working out the speed of sound. Other methods may be more accurate than this method, but this method works. If you connect a microphone to an oscilloscope, you can create a trace that represents the sound. The trace would be a voltage produced by the microphone against time, but the voltage represents the position or movement of the microphone head. The time period can be measured from the time taken from one wave to the next, and you could use the frequency formula, remember that was given on the exam paper, to calculate the frequency of the wave if you knew its time period. Higher sounds have higher frequencies. When an object vibrates, the sound wave we create on the oscilloscope will look different depending on the sound it's producing. The amplitude and the wavelength represent the loudness and the pitch. Can you work out which one of these waves is loudest and which one is highest? The higher the pitch, the shorter the period of a wave. So this one represents the highest pitched sound, because it has the highest frequency and therefore shortest time period. The more an object vibrates, the greater the amplitude will be. So B represents the quietest wave. And the shape of a wave indicates what was vibrating. So all of these were the same instrument, and D was a slightly different instrument. It vibrated in a slightly different way. Humans hear sounds from about 20 to about 20,000 hertz. Although as you get older, this higher end tends to drop off.